Okay, now I know some of you guys have complained about the fact that I say the same thing at the beginning of every video, and I thought about that and I weighed the pros and cons, trying to decide whether or not I should change it to something else, but nah. This is the Daily Overpass. My name is Eric and I make apps. Now today, let's talk about some of the mistakes I made when I first starting out in the industry. Okay, so a few weeks ago on episode 77, I got a message from Harjinder Rugai. He said, I hope I'm pronouncing it right. Sorry, Harjinder. I appreciate all your comments. He said, you should stop saying, my name is Eric and I make apps, because I just skip over that bit. And I basically replied, I'm not going to stop saying it. You guys can complain all you want. I'm going to keep saying it until I think of something else new to say, and then I'm going to keep saying that too. Right? So basically I said, I'm not going to say it. And he said, yeah, that's fine. I suppose people should see it for the first time. He said, it'd be great if you did a few videos on your mistakes in this industry. I've made a few. Harjinder, I mean, guys, I've made loads of mistakes. It's almost like when I looked at this, I thought, there's so much I could do. I could do a whole new channel of mistakes I've made. You know, my daily Eric's mistakes video, right? So I want to talk about a few of them. And there's different areas. And I thought, there's hiring mistakes that I've made, like bringing somebody onto the team. And I've made so many of those. I mean, it's just like, I could talk about those for hours, the mistakes I've made hiring. There's mistakes I've made with clients, especially around pricing and stuff like that. So if you guys are interested in that, I'm happy to tell you about some of the stupid things I've done with clients. But first, let's talk about the App Store, because I think a lot of you guys are interested in. So I was trying to think of it. I haven't really made any mistakes in the app stores or putting apps onto the market. But it did take long for me to remember a few of them. So first of all, one of the first things I did where I kept getting rejected by Apple was we did the EarSpy, and then we did a few other apps, and then we did this language game. And we did the language game with a team in India. We had a designer who was we just didn't have the design skills. So all of our apps, so we did the Mandarin app, and then we did Hindi, and then we did Arabic, and we started doing all these other languages, and we went through like a product, you know, like a not just like we had like a rhythm. We just, you know, first we go to the translators, then we go to the voice artist, then we go to this and all stuff. But we used the same designs for everything. So all the apps looked like exactly the same except for the content and the title screen, and the icon was only slightly different. So we used the same icon, but we had like the text of the language above it. So these were our bubble bath games, and all the bubble bath games looked the same. Right, so we're just putting everything up, and we put it up, you know, because we got in such a flow that you're putting up one a week, and it wasn't, you know, because in the end it was just config changes, and it was like, it was great, right? So, but the problem is, you know, the design were all the same. So eventually, Apple started rejecting these. They started just saying, you're spamming the market. And this became like a real problem for a while where, you know, because we just did not have a designer. And every time I put it to a new designer, they would give me back something. And I said, you know, that's just terrible. And this is why, you know, we have, you know, when I say we have full-time designers on our team now, it's because of this. Because without good design, you know, especially with games, you just can't do anything. I mean, even if you just do like a business app, you need a designer for the icon, but you know, you might not need a full-time person. But when you're doing games, you know, especially back and forth, you know, and you know, like you put something out, like you go to Odesk and hire a designer, and you know, they would do some work and you pay whatever, $100 or a couple hundred dollars. And then somebody comes by and says, I don't like the way that looks, or you should add this. And you're thinking, yeah, but I'm not gonna hire that guy again because he's gone, he's moved on to other projects and all this stuff. So that was one mistake I made. It was just, you know, doing everything the same way and thinking we could just do like a factory type of thing. And I talked to a lot of developers, or so like a lot of, as producers, they're not necessarily developers, where they go into this production line type of mentality where they're just putting things out, you know, all the time. I mean, that was one thing. Another thing I did that, you know, was just really messed things up. I didn't do anything so bad that I got me suspended or terminated or anything like that. But one of the things I did was I wanted to localize these apps to other languages. So, you know, went through, again, to, you know, get localization, get the translators to do everything. But I didn't use, like, localization libraries in the apps, right? I didn't, you know, because you could do all this stuff in iTunes. You could do it in Google Play, add screenshots for every language. you know, all that kind of stuff. But what I did was I just created one app for each one. So at one point I had like hundreds of apps, but they were all the same app. Like I would have the Spanish version of Arabic bubble bath and the Spanish version of Mandarin bubble bath and all this stuff. And it was just, and the and my Google Play console and my iTunes console just started to look really congested with all, they all looked the same. It was the same icon and everything like that. And also because, you know, when you get reviews and you start getting downloads, that starts looking better, you know, for the ASO in general. So if I have like a lot of traffic coming in from, say, from like Spanish users or Portuguese users from Brazil, right, that helps my overall ASO. It helps the ranking of the one app. So once I brought everything into one app and started doing it that way, everything got a lot better and a lot more manageable. But in the early days, that's one of the mistakes I made. So, you know, and sometimes people ask about that. Should I just do one for each language? I said, no, don't. You know, they don't want you to do that. It's not so easy, and it's just better all around if you just do the one app and then localize it within the app. So if their phone is configured to go to be Spanish, then it will show the Spanish and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, just different things like that. I mean, there's just little things that they weren't necessarily crippling, but they just, you know, they slowed everything down, right? So, and this kind of stuff is useful. So, like, when you get an app rejected all the time for the same reason by Apple, right, it's not so bad because you can just resubmit it. I mean, it's not like Google where they suspend it or whatever. So, so that's not so bad. But when you're working with clients, that's really embarrassing. Like if you put something to the App Store and the App Store rejects it because you have to go back to the client and say, oh yeah, I guess we can't use the same icon or something like that. So that's one thing where I'm glad those kind of mistakes happen, and they happen to our own apps. So that's one of the benefits of having our own apps. And for those of you who do your own stuff and then you also do work for clients, I mean, just, you know, try to do as much as you can on your own apps, because those are the learning experiences, right? I had this, I had a client, actually he didn't end up becoming a client, but he did contact us, and he was like, he was telling me the problems he was having with his developer. It was the same kind of stuff, Apple issues, right? And he said, you know, Eric, you gotta help me with this. You know, I have a developer, he seemed really good, but he just doesn't seem to know what he's doing. You know, he's just all over the place. And I said, well, what do you mean? I mean, what's he doing wrong? He goes, well, you know, he's been working on the app for months, so we finally got it done. He deployed it to the App Store, got approved, everything was fine, and then we realized he deployed it to his own iTunes Connect account and not to my iTunes Connect account, right? And then he says, and then so then they shut that one down, moved it to the new account and everything like that. But then the Google Maps API was wrong. And then it was like, there was all this series of problems they had in actually deploying this, because obviously the developer was like, you know, he could develop, but he wasn't, you know, didn't know the whole deployment process. And I mean, it's kind of rude, but I kept laughing when he was telling me this, because I thought it was just, you know, it was like, you know, we're having a joke, but I was the only one who thought it was funny. Right, because I made mistakes like that. Now, and every time I make a mistake, I think I'm glad it didn't happen with a client, because, you know, I'm trying to look like, you know, I know what I'm doing and all this kind of stuff, especially in the early days. So mistakes are a part of things, right? It's just, you know, it's, you have to go through. I mean, you can't let mistakes stop you from doing things, because like I said, a year from now, I'm going to look back at now and think how naive I am right now. So I might as well just assume, you know, accept the fact that I'm naive right now, right? And, you know, 5 years from now, I'm thinking even more naive. When I think about, you know, when I started with apps, you know, I didn't know anything, and, you know, I would make mistakes here and there, and, you know, just, you know, try different stuff. Like, you know, a lot of clients, when they come to us, they say, I say, what we really need to do is get people to leave reviews, right? That's one of the big ways that we get the app, you know, noticed, and we get it to spread and everything like that. And they say, well, maybe we could just unlock a feature if they leave a review, or maybe we could give them something free if they leave a review. And I said, no, terms and conditions don't allow that. And there's loads of things that as a developer, if you work with clients, they're not going to read all the terms and conditions. I mean, I'm not really that good at reading the terms and conditions, but, you know, it's all helpful. So anyway, I'll tell you guys about some of the mistakes I've made with clients, because, man, those are just cringeworthy. Those are just ugh. But anyway, we'll save that for another day. That's it for today. I will talk to you guys tomorrow.